Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. Before we begin, can I ask anyone using electronic devices to please switch them to silent? Members will note that we have a revised agenda item, a revised agenda for today's meeting, and that our stage two consideration of the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Bill has been rescheduled. Before we move on to consideration of our first item, I thought it might be helpful to set out the reasons for this. Due to yesterday evening and this morning's weather, some committee members have not been able to attend today's meeting in person. And whilst the COVID pandemic showed us that we can conduct parliamentary business online, a stage two with debates, intervention, votes on potentially every amendment being managed with members attending online is challenging to manage and vulnerable to a loss of connection or delays. Given the bill team's confirmation to the clerks that there would be no difficulties with postponing stage two consideration by 2 weeks, I took the decision to reschedule to a date where we could all be in the room together and we would be able to hold stage two without those challenges and risks. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. And I appreciate the arguments you've made there. I think it probably came as something of a surprise, certainly to me. I appreciate that it's no fault of the people who can't make it here for the weather, but we have conducted meetings of the committee online or partly online hybrid meetings in the past. We did that through COVID. We have, or I think other committees certainly have handled stage two proceedings. And while the decision may ultimately be your discretion, we didn't really know about this. So I think I would just want to register my curiosity about what we do in future if one person or two people can't make it, and how we avoid a situation that we don't delay legislative proceedings indefinitely.
Thank you. Any other comments? Jim Fairley.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. Yeah, I think one of the things that everybody has done a huge amount of work, and to have had this dropped very late in the afternoon, I understand that it's you as the convener's prerogative to change the agenda, but it would be very nice to have no surprises. We've had this discussion before about no surprises, very late changes to the agenda, and I accept that there are weather conditions. But I don't know about other members, but I've certainly had an awful lot of stakeholder engagement once the decision was made that this would be suspended, asking why this was happening. There's a great deal of disgruntlement amongst stakeholders, and I just think that it would be useful for all of us to be able to know if you are planning to make a decision that I think is a very big decision to reschedule a stage two, that at least we get some indication there's a conversation going on so that we can have it in our own, because I don't know about everybody else, but I was working a lot to get myself prepared for this meeting. And I just think that no surprises principle is quite a good one to have as a convener for the rest of the committee members.
Thank you. I'm pleased that you recognise that the convener has no control over the weather. But I'll just reiterate the reasons for doing this. And unfortunately, trying to give advance notice is difficult when we're dealing with weather conditions. But it's my wish for proceedings of this committee to be as effective and as informed and allow informed debate as possible. For that to happen in this case, there was no adverse impact on our future work programme by delaying proceedings by 2 weeks. I very much appreciate the work that has been done by stakeholders, but that work still is valid and will be equally as valid in 2 weeks' time when we do consider it. And I look forward to Wednesday, the 7th of February, when we will take part in stage two consideration. Thank you. Mr. Allen.
Thank you. Can I, and I appreciate you won't like me saying this, but can I suggest we move to a vote on whether we revert to the original agenda or not?
That's not competent, but thank you. We'll now move on to agenda item one, which is consideration of the Code of Practice for the Welfare of Pigs, Revocation Scotland Notice 2023, which is a document subject to parliamentary approval and follows the affirmative procedure. And I welcome Gillian Martin, Minister for Energy and Environment, and our officials, Andrew Voss, the Veterinary Head of Animal Welfare, and Grant McLarty, the Solicitor from Scottish Government, and invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. The purpose of these draft regulations is to amend the Welfare of Farmed Animals Scotland Regulations 2010 to put a statutory duty on those responsible for looking after farmed pigs to be acquainted with our new guidance for the welfare of pigs. Amongst other things, the 2010 regulations require that those responsible for farmed animals are acquainted with any relevant animal welfare guidance and have access to that guidance while attending to the animal. Non-compliance with those requirements is an offence. Each time a new guidance document is published or revised, reference to this new document must be added to the definition of animal welfare guidance in the 2010 regulations. These draft amendment regulations do just that. The new guidance for the welfare of pigs was published in November last year. So the purpose of these draft amendment regulations is simply to add the new pigs guidance to the definition of animal welfare guidance in the 2010 regulations. The revocation notice that we're also looking at today is simply to revoke the existing but outdated code of practice on the welfare of pigs at the same time. So the combined effect of these then will be that the old pigs code of practice will no longer be in force, and the requirements which had been in force in relation to this code will now apply in relation to the new pigs guidance. And I'm happy to take any questions that any of the members have.
Thank you. I'm going to kick off with the first question. This is the third similar type change from code of practice to a guidance. Can you tell us where this has also been applied and why there a general move away from codes of practice to guidance?
Yeah, so there's two previous guidance notes that have been part of this. That's for meat chickens, the welfare of meat chickens, and the welfare of laying hens. And the reason, and I think the committee will have had a letter from me which set out the reasons for this. The guidance, the reason why we've moved from a code of practice to guidance is that guidance could be published, revised and updated very quickly. As you'll appreciate, issues around animal welfare, farmed animal welfare in particular, it's quite a fast-moving scene. We could have recommendations coming from various, like Animal Welfare Commission or whatever, that we think need to be applied. This guidance is really that. It's guidance that's available for people who are farming these animals, working with these animals, to ensure that their welfare is as good as it can be. You know, things like the accommodation that they have, the conditions that they have to be housed in, for example, are a couple of examples of where the sort of thing that guidance looks at.
So you talk about it. One of the benefits is that new guidance can be brought in very quickly. So that would suggest that there's parts of the process in developing that and putting that guidance in place is different from a code of practice. So what parts of the process are dropped from a code of practice and now we see in guidance? Where are the safeguards, the checks, the consultation, whatever, that are removed to allow it to happen more quickly?
Well, I guess that the fact is we still consult with stakeholders ahead of compiling the guidance. So that part of working with stakeholders, working with animal welfare agencies, working with people in the farming community as well, as to what should be in this guidance is very much a consultative process that officials undertake. I suppose the difference between a code and a guidance document is that although we give the guidance document, we give the committee notice of a guidance document, you actually would have had sight of it, I think, in November. It doesn't have to undergo parliamentary scrutiny in order to be to be applied. So obviously, as you'll appreciate, we're under a great deal of pressure in terms of timing of the work programmes of committees, and we also want to be able to be fleet of foot when it comes to updating or changing guidance. So really what this is doing here is it's just swapping out one document which is outdated for a new updated one, and doing that reasonably quickly so that people have the right information when they're farming their animals.
So in effect, the process is speeded up by removing the ability for Parliament to scrutinise it. Is that a good thing, that removing parliamentary scrutiny?
There's always the... And this is something that my predecessor took forward, Mary McAllen, when she was minister in this portfolio, where she set out the rationale for this change in policy to the committee when she was minister, in terms of what they were going to be doing around the changing the code to the guidance. And the reason is to make the process more streamlined and quicker, because it does take time for codes to go through a process that requires parliamentary scrutiny. When you might have a situation, I was thinking of a situation where there might be stuff like quite pressing updates in animal welfare that would need to be applied quite quickly. So the decision was made that although we weren't going to, with the guidance, remove any of the consultation and working with stakeholders on all of this. And if you have actually, convener, I imagine that you have looked at the guidance that we're talking about. It is very straightforward. It is effectively, advice on how animals, pigs in this instance, should the conditions that they should be in, and everything in terms of their welfare that should be adhered to. So it is actually very straightforward. It's not actually so much any change in policy, because the policy really is in the Act. But the 2006 Act in particular, and the 2010 Act in particular. So it's no change in policy, it is really just a change to guidance.
On that basis, what is concerning is, though, that it would effectively look like government are taking more power and giving Parliament less, but this guidance could be used for enforcement purposes in a similar way to codes of practice, which would suggest that the change from codes of practice to guidance is simply the differences are that we remove all parliamentary scrutiny, which in effect gives the government more power.
I'm not entirely sure that it's a case of power. We are talking about guidance here, not about policy change.
But it does say it can be used for enforcement.
Well, I think that even the codes beforehand would give an idea for any like enforcement agencies as to the standards that were required for the welfare of whichever animal we're talking about. And although it's not binding, it is the binding aspect of it is it should have access to the guidance. And to be quite honest, the guidance and the codes were actually very similar. It was something actually that England and Wales were also looking at. DEFRA was proposing to issue guidance that was jointly owned by government and industry. We decided that our guidance would be government-led, government-owned, which means that we can ensure that the whole range of stakeholders' views are taken into account. Stakeholders are broadly content with that approach. They have been content with that approach for laying hens, and they've been content with that approach for meat chickens as well. So really what is happening today, what we're putting forward, is not so much the policy change from code to guidance, because that was done by my predecessor in front of the committee. What today is actually a very technical instrument, which is swapping out the pigs code of practice to pigs guidance on pig welfare.
Thank you. Jim Phelan and Rhoda Grant.
Thanks, Convener. This is just a curiosity. You're talking about how you're consulting with stakeholders. Is there a requirement, or is that just something that the government do as a matter of course?
There's not a requirement, but we don't operate that way. We don't. It is not in our interest, and it's not in the interest of the sector, mm-hmm. for government to act in a way in which we produce guidance in a vacuum. That guidance has to be something that the stakeholders are invested in. It has to be done in collaboration. In our view, it has to be done in collaboration with them, in order to land properly, in order to be used, and in order to be trusted. So that is the approach that we'll always take to anything like this that we produce, and that's the approach. There's nothing that compels us to do that, but it is actually good. It's good practice.
That was the point I was trying to get. This is a collaborative approach,
yes.
that the industry are very much behind, and they can see the value of it.
Yes.
Thank you.
Just before I moved to Rhoda, a supplementary to that, was there formal obligations or requirements for consultation under the Code of Practice?
Well, I'll maybe pass to Andrew because he was involved in the Code of Practice.
Yeah, there is a formal obligation to consult on a Code of Practice, but there isn't that formal obligation to consult on guidance. But as the Minister said, we obviously did consult very extensively with the industry and had very detailed discussions with a large number of interested parties in preparing the guidance.
Okay, so just to be clear, this revocation of the practice and introduction of the guidance removes the requirement for consultation.
Yeah, but maybe it's worth me sort of going over what I imagine Ms McCallum would have said to the committee at the time. So the move from welfare codes to welfare guidance documents was discussed in advance with all the key stakeholders. And before the publication of that first guidance document, the then minister asked officials to discuss this change further with animal welfare organisations and the sector. And they were content with the move. Officials had further discussions off the back of that with OneKind, Compassion and World Farming, confirmed that they didn't raise any objections. They had consulted with the sector, the position remains that since these guidance documents have been put in place, but for the laying hens and for the meat chickens, there has been absolutely no pushback as to the guidance documents rather than the codes of practice.
Yeah, I suppose just what I wanted on record was that this removes the requirement for formal consultation. At which is, you've just confirmed that.
Yeah, but there's consultation that still happens, and of course the decision to change from the code to the guidance is already something that has happened. What today is doing is just adding another document to that guidance and removing the outdated guidance, outdated code rather.
Okay, Rhoda Grant.
We've had no concerns about this expressed to us, but it could be in the future, when the guidance has changed, that we do get concerns coming to us about that, especially when there is no consultation with the committee. What would we do in that case? Would the minister appear in front of the committee to discuss those concerns?
I will always appear in front of the committee if they have concerns on anything in my portfolio. I am not going to sit here and say it's only if there's a formal reason to have something. If you've got concerns on guidance, but I would really be hopeful that that wouldn't happen, and the reason why I don't think it would happen is because guidance and changes to that guidance in the future would be done in consultation with all stakeholders well in advance of that guidance being changed or published.
It's good to have that backstop. Thank you.
Any further questions? No. We move on to the formal consideration of the motion to approve the notice. I invite the Minister to move motion S6M 11748.
Okay, I move that the draft Welfare Farmed Animals Scotland Amendment Regulations be approved.
Thank you. Does any member wish to debate the motion? No.
I have read the wrong thing out. Can I just revise what I said? I move that the Code of Practice for the Welfare of Pigs Revocation Scotland Notice 2023 be approved, and apologies for that mistake.
Are we sure that is the motion S6M 11748? that the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee recommends that the Code of Practice for the Welfare of Pig Rectification Scotland Notice 2023 be approved.
Okay. Moved.
Moved, thank you. Does any member have wish to debate the motion? No. Is the committee content to recommend approval of the notice? Finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a report on our deliberations on this notice? Thank you. That completes consideration of the notice. We now turn to consideration of the Welfare of Farmed Animals Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. Gillian Martin, the Minister for Energy and the Environment, and our officials are still with us, Andrew Voss and Grant Clarty. And I invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
I don't have a further opening statement to make on this. I think I've included everything in my original statement.
Thank you. Any members have any questions? No. We now move to the formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument. And I invite the Minister to move the motion.
So I move that the Draft Welfare of Farmed Animals Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024 be approved.
Does any member wish to debate the motion? No. Is the committee content to recommend approval of the instrument? And finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a report on our deliberations of the affirmative instrument? We are. And that completes consideration of the affirmative instrument. And that concludes our business for today. And I now close this meeting.